Kids, stay here. Don't go out there to your disservice, okay? I want you to hold the doors.
The words of Nehemiah, son of Hakaliah, the man of Kisri, the 20th year, while I was in the citadel of Susa. Hanani, one of the brothers, came from Judah with some other men, and I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that had survived exile, and also about Jerusalem. They said to me, those who survived exile are back in the province, are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates have been burned with fire. When I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days, take note of the word some days, I don't know how many days, because it was a 3 months preparation in Jordan of Nehemiah. I mourned, take note of the word mourn, very important word, and fasted and prayed before the God of the heaven. And I said, Lord, the God of the heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open today to hear the prayer of your servant. Is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly towards you. We have not obeyed commands, decrees, and laws you gave your servant Moses. Remember the instruction you gave your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands, then even if your exiled people are at the farthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. They are your servants and your people whom you have redeemed by your great strength and your mighty hand. So, Father, we thank you. I praise, Lord, for the word of life that we're going to partake this afternoon. Help us to be able to know the very heart that you are revealing to us, your heart. The very message, the very essence of this wonderful message, so we can hear and then, Lord, receive. And then, Lord, I pray that it will be activated. I thank you because every time we come together, you have a message. And because you are the head, and you are the leader, you are the communicator to us, and you are recipient of God and all the graces that you have promised. Bless the Lord, sanctify this place. We love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Thank you so much. Rise up to build. God gave success. Now, dirty saints of God and beloved of the Lord, God has bought you with his precious blood, and because of that, it is a privilege that we can come together this afternoon to worship him in one heart. That is the very essence when we come together to worship God in one heart, because we are bought with a price, and then we enjoy the freedom where the Spirit of the Lord is. When the Spirit is moving, there is freedom. And so this afternoon our topic is very relevant to the context of our time. The condition of our time and our lives as believers in the Lord, how we express our lives and our faith today, is very important in the nation of Australia, in the continent of Australia, to the place God has brought you and me in the New South Wales, and we're in Riverstone, and I knew that God would expand in the horizon into the other countries that God has allowed us to become an influence. And we are a part of the work, and they are a part of the work of Christ the Nation Ministries in India and Pakistan, as we pray together, as men, as people of God, craving that something's going to happen. You know, what is happening in that land or in the Hindu country, they're killing of pastors right now, as Pastor Jacob is showing to us what had happened there. And I tell you what happened to them. Every year is beat up in that place for the last 20 years. Never give up. Now, it is important in our faith today. Now, the question is, why is this important as we will go in a few moments to rise up to build, God give us the success. Why it is important to rise up into our part today? What is happening in the world today, God has given us the message. Why it is important? Because the challenge of today is vast, big. It is huge. But even though it is huge and big, we will conquer in many servants of God today. It might be some kind of just a flickering light. They can conquer, we can conquer them, and we will see the victory in Riverstone, in Ross Hill, in some of the pastors that are associated with us, in other churches that are sensitive to the voice and the spirit of the living God. We will see the victory and success to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We will see that. We will see that. Because God is not an idol, He's alive and He's working in our hearts, in my heart, in your heart. And that's why we are a living organism that continues to grow and to move under the power and protection of God Almighty. Now, in this study, chapter 1, Nehemiah, the book of Nehemiah, and the author is Nehemiah. He's not even members of the clan of the priests. He's not even members of the prophets and the old. He's one of the guys who rise up to what he believes is right. I love it when you feel led by God to do something for the Lord. Don't wait too long. Do something, because God is moving and trusting and counting on you. When since you received the blessing from the Lord. So, he rise up in that occasion and do something in the mission that God has called him to do. And you know what happened? He experienced success. Now, I have principle I have taken down just this afternoon. I was in Nurajinji, some place, thank God. I was so blessed because it was some few people that prepared for little, you know, some kind of picnic there. And there's one of the tables, and they come about three or four of them. And later on, while I was meditating, they turn on the radio or their recording machine. The other one is a little bit wondering what is irritating to the ear already. And I don't want to say to them, hey, we'll do this up. Later on, they make it louder, which I cannot concentrate on the message I'm giving to you this afternoon. I was quiet, I was silent. No. And praying to the Lord. I was in my mind, Lord, what should I do? Should I go to my house or I am almost half on my preparation. And I just quiet and meditating the Lord. Then later on, the sound becomes lesser and lesser. I said, oh, thank God. I was like, bless them. I don't know. They listen to the sound. Bless them, oh God. Later on, the sound is fading. When I look to the table where they are doing some kind of, you know, barbecuing, that is surprised me. It blessed me because they move out. And I can see the sound of the parish bells. I didn't even ask to move them out because I am not in the position to tell them God move them out and bring them in the other side of the big part of Nurajinji. Amazing! And so, what a blessing. So, I take down some principles and I give to you important principles. Principle that really is going to be a principle that I have taken down that are doable. You can do it. a principle that is applicable, principle that is needed now, and a principle that is timely, and a principle, and is a principle that is lifetime, that will give you success. So apply this. I see it in the book of Nehemiah. Principle. Okay, by the way, principle, you have to pay the price if people have the success. Principle is two things. A principle is a determining characteristic of an essential quality. You can see it's a little bit compound. Essential quality, what do you mean? Pastor Kani, quality of what? It is an adaptive rule or method for application of that quality to be to action. So this principle is something that we are going to hear, and we are going to enjoy, that we are going to receive, that you are going to own this, own that, and then apply. And you see the principle and the blessing of success based on the book of Nehemiah. Now, apply it. First, we want to see the condition of the people of God, Israel in Jerusalem. Let's go back to see the verse 2 and verse 3. Look at that. Verse 2 and verse 3. These are the people. They are, you know, they become, they're Jewish people under the control of a big kingdom from the Nebuchadnezzar to Persian Empire to the time of Artaxerxes. The people from Judah, we can see in verse 3, who survived. They're back in Jerusalem in great trouble, in disgrace. Walls are broken down, gates are burned up. The people of God in this history, so you can see their background, and we can apply it in our present dilemma or situation of the Christian church. The people of God are in extremely, extremely mournful condition. In other words, they're crying, they don't know what to do. They are completely exasperated. And the condition, it was tragic, dreadful. It is, you will be fatigued, and be weary, and weariness, and exhausting. Now, verse 3, in our translation, the people of God, were in distress. The word that is used, great, not only distress, great distress. Great trouble, in other translation. Now, when you are in great trouble, so we can see, that be able to digest this as I expound. It means that they are in great pain. That's the condition of the believers in the world, great pain. Not only great pain, it was an acute physical, mental suffering. We could not figure it out. Torture of the mind, physically exhausted and troubled and painful, and they were troubled in comfort to see that they were blamed. Everything was pointing on them. They're completely shattered into pieces and no way of life survival. But God did something extraordinary. It is a state of extreme misfortune. Not only misfortune, we have some problem. We have no more other solution. This is it. We are currently carrying this body. That's nothing compared to them. A tip of an iceberg. A tip. So your problem, my problem, is nothing. They were in extreme misfortune or calamity. Too much. Now, another thing you can see, the wall, as you can see there, the wall of Jerusalem, their identity, what happened, broken down. I'll explain to you in a few moments. And the gates, which is the security, some kind of a place of refuge and a place of peace, it was burned down with fire. So, what happened to them? I want you to see. Verse 4, first principle. When I heard these things, he heard this. He sat down and wept. for some days. I don't know how long, because he was doing these things for 3 months. More, and then no food, fasted, and prayed before God of heaven. This is something applicable on any problems that you might have had or before, and you might have today, regardless of the intensity, regardless of the weight. This principle is applicable today, and maybe mountain of problems that eventually would come, is still you will survive. It's principle work, and it will work to all of us this afternoon. Principle number one, because of what happened, personal prayer, number one, an indispensable, unavoidable need in your life now. Take note of that. Please receive that now. Because I explained to you why we need it now. It is the need now to pray. When Nehemiah heard the report, he sat down, and the next word was, he wept. He mourned for days. There is some kind of lament, something that is painful emotionally, mentally, in the deepest membrane of the human heart. Something that is unexpressible. He mourned for days. Now the Bible clearly revealed the principle in the life of Nehemiah. He fasted, and take note of the next word, and praying. The word praying is a constant, continually, non-stop praying to God, to the God of the heavens. I love that. Take that. Either we're lying down, your mind is praying, thanking God, washing the dishes, your heart is praying. Whatever you do, your mind revolt and pray. I tell you, you will become a victorious believer in Christ. He passed the prayer. Now there is a constant, continued communication to God. It was an ongoing opening up of his heart to God, to the condition of his people, Israel. They're broken down. The walls are burned. His people are deprived to worship God, the freedom to worship the God of the heavens and the earth. They were deprived, they were constrained, they were constrained, they were confined. There is no expression of freedom as we have today. We can do anything to God. God were free. They were confined. A very teachable, horrible place to be in the life of a person. Now listen, this constant praying of Nehemiah touched the very heart of God. Now we might question why. Number one, in the principle of praying, personal prayer is indispensable. It is needed, unavoidable. Now, the reason why he touched the heart of God, it was a prayer of compassion. You cannot afford to see his people continue to suffer. It was a prayer of compassion to his own people, Israel. It was, for it is a prayer that touched Nehemiah deeply, the physical need of the people of God. They are deprived of many things. There is no expression of a real powerful nation and people that are blessed of God. They are just junk. They are not leftover second-class citizens. And so Nehemiah prayed. He was touched deeply because of the physical condition of the people of God. It touched him so much because of the spiritual need of the people in the nation of Israel. And it touched him so much because the walls are broken. And they were overpowered with fear and discouragement and hopelessness. A horrible place to be. Why? Now in Jerusalem, walls symbolizes a place that you have a defense. If there's an intruder, it's not that easy to penetrate the wall. And if the gates is broken down, that is an invitation to the enemies to come in any time without any resistance. Come on, let's enjoy this. Jewish people is open. There is no door, there is no gate, there is no wall. Let's enjoy everything that we can get. And so Nehemiah mourned for his people who had been bound and is stifled by the previous decree of the king from the time of Israel that they cannot build the wall and the worship is constrained. Thank God it was restored in Israel's time, when there was a revival. He stopped rebuilding the temple until such and such time that the king will sign its okay now, even in the Nehemiah. It was in force. But thank God for Nehemiah. He is a man, not a priest, not member of the prophets, or any kind of religious sect in the olden time, with the heart to respond to the need of the hour. You know, church, we are in the history of the church. I want you to hear this. We are in the history. When I say church, it's not the building, it is not the name. You are talking about people. You are in the history of the church, of the living God, where people has no appetite or desire to pray. It was, there was a census 2 years ago, and I was so shocked that pastor in Australia, their prayer life is 5 minutes a day. It shocked me. It was 5 minutes a day. Prayer to many believers define, this is sad. As I meditate on